Hi, everyone. Okay, so the goal of today's talk, Lee had asked me, she said a lot of volunteers want to use the bee exhibit here at Coyote Point more and want to be able to talk to the public about bees, but don't know what to say. And so what I'm hoping with this talk is to give you some things that you can talk to the public about when
you're
there's about 9 species of honeybees worldwide. So ants, bees, and wasps are all related to each other. The fossil evidence, and here's a bee that's trapped in amber, indicates that the ancestor of bees evolved approximately 70 million years ago.
And
the evidence in the fossil record suggests that bees evolved, co-evolved very closely with the flowering plants. So when you're pointing out the bees in the bee exhibit to the public, you can talk about them in the same way you talk about insects in general. So
all insects, all of them, will have 3 body parts,
their head, thorax, and then abdomen. So they'll take different shapes and they'll look different, but it's always, always there in all insects. And a good thing to remember, the head has a lot of the sensory organs. So it has the eyes, the antennae. It also has the mouth parts. The thorax, the way you can tell the thorax from the abdomen is everything that has to do with locomotion is on the thorax. So if it has a leg attached to it, if it has wings attached to it, it's the thorax. It's not the abdomen. And then the abdomen is the end part, and it's full of all of the major organ systems. So it has part of the circulatory system. It has all of the digestive system, it has the reproductive system, and it also will have the stinger or the ovipositor at the end. Bees have 2 pairs of wings, so a lot of times around here locally you'll see at flowers things that look like bees, but they actually only have 1 pair of wings, and those are flies that are mimicking bees. Flies only have a single pair of wings. The bees' wings, though, it's a little tricky because if you're looking at the bees in the hive and you're telling children or other members of the general public that they have 2 pairs of wings instead of just 1, their wings kind of look attached. And the reason is they have these Velcro-like hooks called hamuli that actually couple the wings for flight. And so you'd actually have to take like a pin or something like that and run it between the wings, and you can kind of open these hamuli. And then they'll reattach together. But they have wings that are somewhat coupled. So they don't always look obvious, but if you look really close, there are 2 pairs of wings. They have chewing mouth parts, so same kind of mouth parts that beetles and grasshoppers have, except that they have a modified maxilla and glossa that form a proboscis, or a long tongue, kind of like a butterfly has, a little bit different looking. It doesn't curl up, but that'll stick out when they're eating nectar or honey. And then this is one of the funnest things that you can use as a fun fact. Kids love this. The stinger on a honeybee is a modified ovipositor. So the ovipositor is like a little tube that an insect uses to lay eggs in dirt or in under bark or in a plant or in another insect, wherever they're going to lay their eggs. So in bees, the ovipositor is what the stinger has evolved from. So what does this mean? Can male bees sting? They can't. And so in all of the hymenoptera, males can never, ever, ever sting. Males will have behaviors that'll mimic stinging behaviors. So I've held male bees that will start to buzz at you, and they'll even stick the tip of their abdomen like this on your skin. And you have to just know that you're a male, and if you can tell that they're a male, and we'll talk about how you can tell a honeybee is a male, they can't sting you at all. Genetics, because they are different than the genetics of a lot of animals, they are haplodiploid. And what this means is that while the females have 2 sets of chromosomes, which is what you usually see in the animal kingdom, the males only have 1 set of chromosomes. And they're produced from unfertilized eggs. So if our queen bee wants to produce male offspring, she simply lays eggs without fertilizing them. And this has interesting implications in terms of the evolution of sociality. Some people say that this is the main reason that honeybees are social, because it actually means that the sister bees in the hive are more closely related to each other. There's a little equation you can do, but it turns out that they share 3/4 of their genes rather than just 1/2. But this doesn't occur in termites, so it doesn't completely explain the evolution of sociality. So people are still debating overall why that occurs in the animal kingdom. About honeybee development. So honeybees go through what's called complete metamorphosis. And this is the same thing that butterflies go through that we teach kids about. It's the same thing that flies go through with maggots. This is the same thing that beetles go through. And so they have an egg, a larva, a pupa, and an adult. And so here's in the top here are larvae. Sometimes you can see them a little bit in the hive. The pupa will be when it's covered up, because the larvae, they'll leave the top of the cell open, and so they can feed the larvae, but the pupa don't eat, and that's when they're developing into the adults. And so they'll be covered up cells, and then you'll see them chew their way out as the adult bee. And the female larvae develop into workers or queens, depending on the amount and the type of food that they get. And in honeybees, there are three types of bees that you'll see in the hive. There's the queen, which is female, the drone, which is the male, right there, and the workers, which are also female. And the workers are the vast majority, 99% of the bees you see in a hive usually. If they have drones, then maybe more like 90% or so. The honeybee queen is, under normal conditions, the only reproductive female in the hive. If the queen dies, the workers will start to produce offspring, but because the workers are not mated, they can only produce drones, and so usually the colony collapses at that point unless they're able to produce another queen in time, which they sometimes are. And the difference between the queen and the workers is simply that the queen larvae are fed a special substance called royal jelly. So a queen bee will lay many eggs, and if the queen dies, for instance, the larvae will start feeding some, or the adults will start feeding some of the larvae royal jelly in hopes of producing a queen. So that's the only difference between the queen and the larvae. As far as in fertilization, it isn't determined that the queen is going to be a worker. I said larvae. I meant the queen mates once. This is another fun fact about all insects that you can share, depending on the age of the kids. All insects have an organ that's called the spermatheca. In that organ, they can store sperm in a viable state for up to several years. So from a single mating with a male, they can then produce fertilized eggs for years after that. So our queen will only mate once on her mating flight, and then she'll fertilize eggs from that mating up to several years, up to her full lifetime of 5 years. She will lay 1,500 to 2,000 eggs per day when she's in full reproductive mode, like especially at a time like this time of year in the summer when it's warm. And the females use pheromones to control hive behavior. The drones, I love the drones. I wish we had drones right now, and we'll have drones really soon, I'm pretty sure, if the hive is as healthy as it looks. So the drones are haploid. Like we said, they only have one set of chromosomes. They're really big, kind of chunky-looking bees. Their eyes actually touch at the top of their head, so they kind of look a little cross-eyed. And remember that they can't sting. So at UC Davis, actually, they used to hand out drones to kids during one of the demonstrations about bees. And kids could actually hold the drones in their hands and pet them and do that sort of thing, because they can't sting you at all. So the only thing that the honeybee drones do is that they fertilize the queen. That's their only job. They're never going to be cleaning in the hive. They're never going to be foraging. They're never doing anything but doing their mating flight. So until they do their mating flight, when they're waiting to reach sexual maturity, they just hang out in the hive. So when we do get drones here, you'll see them, these big kind of bees hanging out, doing nothing, while all the other worker bees are busy around them, feeding and foraging and doing other things. And then they'll actually bring food to the drones and feed the drones. They only live 4 to 6 weeks, and they die during the mating process. Their genitalia actually detaches into the queen bee, and so then they die. The honeybee workers are the non-reproducing females, like we said, under normal conditions. So if there is a problem with the queen, they may start reproducing, but not very successfully. And this is, like I said, the vast, vast majority of bees in the hive. And they do all of the work activities for the colony, other than laying the eggs like the queen does. And they live 3 to 6 weeks in the summer or 3 to 7 months in the winter. And that's because in the winter, they're basically hunkering down and in survival mode and just keeping warm, and they're not as active. In bees, they rotate their jobs depending on the age. So all the jobs are done by the workers, like I said, and then it's completely based on how old that particular worker is. And here's the breakdown of this labor system. So you can also use this when you're interpreting the honeybee hive for kids, because if you see a worker doing a particular job, you can say, that bee is about.
Please continue on to part 2 of Bee Talk with Dr. Stephanie Dole.